yelele, oh yelele, oh yelele, mama we. Yelele, mama we, yelele, mama we, oh oh.
Now we'll move on to our keynotes, and I'm honored to introduce them. We have Terry Flowers and Tim Page, and I'll read a little bit about them, and then they'll speak with us. Terry Flowers, her work in urban agriculture started in 2006 as a volunteer with the nonprofit organization Urban Farming. This experience soon developed into a full-time position managing a national garden installation project. Terry and Tim Page started Holistic Health Farms in early 2011 and continued growing produce using sustainable organic and regenerative methods and selling at Mill City Farmers Market. Page and Flowers was started in order to market products that were not necessarily farm-related, including their value-added products. Their work has included education and consulting with various organizations. Tim Page has spent much of his adult life working with youth and families at risk of chemical dependency and homelessness. He focuses on all aspects of community organizing and development. He and Cherry started Holistic Health Farms in early 2011, and it has provided a platform for Tim to help others develop skills and knowledge in the areas of entrepreneurism, food production, preparation and preservation, product development, marketing, health and wellness, personal empowerment, prevention, and even the construction of items related to garden projects like compost bins, raised beds, aqua and hydroponics, water catchment system, high tunnels, and deer fences. What accomplishments. We're really lucky to have you here, and welcome.
Good morning. I wanted to first say one of the things in the brochure says that we represent Frogtown Farm right now. We're not here to talk about Frogtown this morning, but more about how we actually started our own personal business. Like with everybody else, a lot of people's, one day we won't have to have a job and be able to do farming only, but right now that's not the case. Yes. So for me, I started out farming from doing youth work. I had a couple of 4-H clubs, and we were working on health and physical education. And from that, I thought if I'm working on health with kids, one of the things I should do is help teach them how to grow some of their own food. We used to cook for another group of youth, and we would get most of the stuff out the garden, but they would always run across the street and get pop and different stuff. So that's how I started farming. And this is just a picture with some of the youth that we worked with. This is at Van White Garden. This was an old lot. One of the things when we started out, we were looking for spaces. And my first space was an old gas station. Then we redid that and made it into a garden. This is it. And this is actually the first farmers market that we did, one little table and a few vegetables. And this is within a year, this is our market stand at Mule City Farmers Market. And what we did, the youth used to, we would work with them to grow the vegetables. But if you have children, you know, when you ask them something about doing any kind of work, the first thing they say is, am I going to get paid for this? And the last thing they asked is when. So this, for them to do the gardening, we first had to, we had to figure out what the end project was going to be, because it's a long time starting working in June and then getting paid in September. So, but we worked with them to grow the vegetables, and then we went to Mill City's market, and they actually did the stand and sold everything.
Good morning. So as we were introduced, the way that I started in urban agriculture was working with a nonprofit organization, Urban Farming. And part of my initial volunteer work was finding different sites in the city where we could locate community gardens that were communally grown, and people would come together and do some work, take some food. Not always the same people doing the work and taking the food, and that was kind of part of that mission. And so I worked with a lot of people in the community to start different urban farms. So the first one here is at 12th and Morgan, and this is where actually some of the kids that Tim was working with Emerge, would come and help at that 12th and Morgan garden. We brought in lots of new soil, which is often the case in urban agriculture, where the soil that's there just isn't going to grow anything, or it's contaminated in some way. And so here we brought in a couple of semi-loads of soil and spread that, and then started growing there, and then brought community together around it. You can go ahead. This is the Frogtown CDC, which is in St. Paul. So this was another urban farming garden that was started with community in that neighborhood. And it was really a fun site because there was kind of a presentation space. And we found that in general, wherever we were doing community garden type of work, it was nice for there to be a combination of growing things and then also a way to bring community together. And then this is North End Community Garden. This was actually adjacent to a site that we also grew for market. So we had a separate area that was for community to grow. And then we were growing on about a half acre of land there. There was a 3-acre site, and there were three different growing groups. And we'll talk about that more later. And then, do you want to? So this is just a map of some of the sites that we've used for growing for market, and we're not alone in this as urban farmers, as often there are multiple sites, which is a little bit complicated sometimes as far as just sort of the running around. The one that was furthest away was at West Branch, which is about an hour away. So this is our headquarters, our urban headquarters. And so basically a double lot in the Hamlin Midway neighborhood. And you can see in this slide our hoop house. And this is a hoop house that we put up, I want to say in 2011, 2012. And it was secondhand. So we got this hoop house from somebody in Lake Elmo, and we drove up there and took a bunch of pictures of it, and then Tim, with some support, went up there and took it apart piece by piece, and so that was the instruction manual for putting it back together again. So we put that up on the side of the house, and it was 32 by 60, which is a pretty good size hoop house for the middle of St. Paul. And pretty quickly, the city of St. Paul came by and said, I don't think so. And so we were asked to take it back down. So we did take it back down. And then you'll see a little further forward what we did to change that. But then basically what we wanted to talk about is just site development. So at this site, we happened to have a pretty steep hill at the front. And we knew that water management there was an issue. And so we built a Berman swale into that front hill, which is basically, you know, a lump of soil, a swale that captures water, another lump of soil, another swale that captures water, so that as the water would come down the hill, it'd be captured in each swale and then slowly absorb into the berm where the roots of the plants could take it up. And so it's a way to not just let your water and your resources and your soil just disappear from your site. So keeping the soil healthy. Okay. And this is just the further development of that Berman swale. And then here's when we had some plants planted in it. And we do try to do crop rotation. We're pretty focused on the certified organic aspect of things and just sustainability. And so this year we had things in the cucurbit family planted out there with some companion plants nearby that benefited those as well. Okay.
So one of the things she talked about was plant rotation. Plant rotation is when you don't want to plant the same thing in the same place every year, because different so it helps your soil if you plant different things in that place each year. So that's what rotation is simply not planting the same thing in the same place year to year. Water retention and berm and swale is on our hill, everything used to wash down. And I think every day when I went out, not every day when I went out to, or was forced to go out and mow the lawn, I probably cussed that hill out about every day. So that was part of the reason why we did the berm and swale, and it helped helped us to grow a little more also. And this is the inside of the first hoop house that we made. And so one of the things we did with it is we wanted to maximize everything. So we have stuff planted in the ground. We have stuff planted under those plants. We had stuff hanging and everything. And with this one, like for us, a lot of the things we just had to learn. When we got this hoop house, we probably had started talking a couple few months before, and I had seen one. I think we had went to Growing Power and I seen the hoop house and they had built, and I was like, I want one of them. And so I started putting away a little money, and this one came up quicker than we thought, so we had to go up, take it down, put it back up, and kind of the next thing was to figure out how we were going to how to actually use it. And that's season extension. So, and this is the outside of it. This is it after we turned it, the city made us turn it. So you'll see a little black pond. We built a 1,500 gallon aquaponics system inside it when it was the long way. And when the city told us we had to turn it, make it smaller, then we end up not with the aquaponics system. Now it's a pond in the yard. And also you see the sides are rolled up. When we got it, the roll-up sides weren't on there. And so it used to get super hot. So one of the first things we had to figure out was we wanted hot. You know, we were thinking 80, 90 degrees, 100 degrees. We could do some tomatoes and sweet potatoes. But on average, it's 20 degrees hotter in there than it is outside. So when it got 80 degrees, it was 100 degrees. And one of those years, it was getting 100 degrees, and it was just terrible in there. So we figured out how to make the roll-up sides. One of the things, when you have a hoop house, you have to know some irrigation. And so this is a water catchment system that Cherry did a grant for, and she put some gutters on the side of it, and some gutters, and then the barrels. So the water that would run off of the hoop house would go into the barrels and fill all of those up, and we had them hooked up to a solar. And we had them hooked up to this solar thing, and so we saved a lot on water. So the water would go into those pots, into those things, and then you see a little water thing at the end. Did you want to tell them about this? So, and then that's an irrigation thing. So we had a little pump that would pump water through the plants, and that saved a lot of money. And this is North Branch. One of the things that we had to do when we started out, that's where we started at, in our yard. And so we needed more space. So this is at North Branch at WI, the Women Environmental Institute. And I think we did about a half acre tool at the maximum. It was an acre that we used to do there. And probably like a lot of y'all, it would take us, Carlson, who was driving, 45 minutes. If I was driving, maybe an hour, if she was driving. So that was 2 hours in a day that was going to nothing. And we would go up there and we would work for 6 hours and stuff. So in an 8 hour day, a fourth of our time was spending on the road. But I learned a lot there. I learned to drive a tractor, do some different things. I really appreciated that from Jackie and Karen.
And I wanted to mention that this was a great opportunity for us to learn more about a certified organic farm. You know, the things that you really have to do to be aware of, things you have to be aware of in order to make sure that your stuff stays certified organic. I know that was tricky for them, having a lot of different farmers up there working on their land to make sure that all of the processes were, you know, were respected, and that people were keeping track of the things that had to be kept track of, and that the records were kept properly. But it was really good education for us to work up there and learn more about certified organic, and that has helped us later. Which one are we on? What slide? This is you. It's over here.
Okay. One of the things, so we had to learn to work with the city, because when we put up the first hoop house, we went to the city and asked them what we needed or what they needed from us, and I think they said, well, we don't know what we need from you, and we went and put it up, and they came back and said, we'll take it down. And this is a deer fence. A deer fence is a fence that's 10 feet high, and we didn't really have experience with that, and I didn't really know anybody who had experience, so we kind of had to teach ourselves. These are some of the, and teaching ourselves, once we put up about half of the fence, then I said to myself, well, we got it now. So we started inviting other people in to help, and we would teach them. One of the things we do in the way I learn is by experience. I could sit and read something and all of that, and I won't get it. But if I go out and I start doing it, then I could figure it out. So these are some youth that we worked with. And these are some neighborhood people who were laying out the actual fence wire. And you can see in the back we have the fence up. And this hoop house or high tunnel is our second one. And we actually got this one from NCRS. And I think we paid $7,000 for this, and I think they paid five of that $7,000 for it. And back again, we had to figure out how to put it up. You could see the little poles sticking out the ground. Yeah, those are the footings, and those are only like 4 feet long, and you have to put those in the ground 2 feet. And It was the only complicated part really for me was figuring out how to square them up. Once we had them squared up, it was pretty easy, and we just Googled how do you square up a building. And this is the hoop house. Once it's up, we start yesterday when we were talking, we always start with lettuce. And so those are all rows of lettuce. And then between the rows, if you point to between them, those are all starter plants that we would start our plants for the field inside the hoop house. So it serves a lot of purposes. If you could probably see outside, it's probably a foot of snow on the ground outside, and we were doing this inside. I think this was March or April.
I just wanted to say a little bit too about regulations. Like with the hoop house, we definitely had a learning curve. We had put the hoop house up at our home, and we had to take it down, and we had to make it smaller in order to fit the proper number of buildings and amount of space covered on our lot. So we ended up with the hoop house at home being 30 by 32 instead of 32 by 60. And then when we put up the hoop house at North End, basically, nobody had put up a high tunnel in St. Paul in recent history. And so when you went to talk to the city of St. Paul, they were basically like, well, it's not me, and it's not me, and it's not me, and it's not me. It sort of fell in the middle. So we had to get a whole bunch of people together for them to talk about how it could be done or if it could be done. And then with the deer fence, it was sort of the same thing. You know, typically a fence in the city of St. Paul in your front yard is 4 feet and in your backyard is 6 feet, and this was a 10-foot fence. And so we had to get a variance in order to do that fence. In our third year growing at North End, that land basically went, I'm just going to read this slide. So basically, it's our third year of production. The landowner lost the land back to the city. The city was not willing to renew leases for the people farming the land. They had different plans for the land at that point. And the deer fence and the hoop house that we had built the year before were dismantled, and they had to be moved by the end of the season. So that was a really unexpected development for us. I mean, we thought we were going to be there for a number of years, and that didn't end up happening. And that just brings up the point that land permanence is a really big issue in urban agriculture. I think it can be a big issue in general. So land permanence being the ability to use the land for a period of time that makes sense for farming. I mean, the first few years, you're really just building the soil and trying to get things ready to farm and to grow. And so to lose your land and after the third year is sort of doesn't work very well for farming. So this is you, Tim. Do you want me to okay. So basically, eventually, we decided that we wanted a different image for some of our products. And we worked with NOC. They're a really, really lovely organization over in North Minneapolis. And they helped us to develop a new logo, new image, page, and flowers. And so we use these logos on our products. Okay. Do you want to see something else? Or? And then beyond just growing food in the ground and bringing it to market, there are a lot of other things that we've been doing over the past few years in order to kind of cobble it all together. We have a diverse product and service mix that gives us multiple streams of income. So we've done work with value-added products, developed other products that are kind of farming related. We've done education, tours, demonstration, consulting work, public speaking, farm tourism / hosting international students. And then also, as Tim was saying, kind of, I'll call it off-farm work, because usually when people are working on a farm, they might get a job in the city or in the town or something. In our case, our off-farm work was like on a farm or at a market. All right, go to vegetable production, the next one. Okay, that's you.
So I'll go back a little. Part of once we started, we thought we were just going to do farming, and we thought farming was just growing vegetables and taking them to market. And we soon found out that it was a lot more than just getting your vegetables and taking them to the market. We learned that we had to clean them, you had to store them, you had to shine them up to look better than the next person over, tomato and stuff. And that's how we started going into the value-added products. And it started, too, from being in North Branch. If we missed 2 or 3 days going up there, we were doing zucchini. And if you miss 2 or 3 days of zucchini this big, it's going to be this big. So the first thing we say, we can't just leave them. So we started, she started shredding the zucchinis, and we would make zucchini muffins, and then the rest we would freeze and wait to make more. So that's how we started the value-added products. But our main thing was vegetable production, and we knew that we needed to do the regular vegetables, but we kind of needed a niche also. So we started doing ground cherries, and then we also wanted to do culturally important vegetables, because some people really have problems finding their traditional vegetables. And for me, I always like doing collard greens, you know, even though we weren't going to make a lot of money off of them, we could cook them. And this is more of what we do today. Now, we do herb infused vinegars, and that's herbs. So the herbs that we grow, we would take them and we would make vinegar. So today we're doing microgreens, and moved more to growing inside. And we do the microgreens because they're a high value crop, and they could take as little as 10 days from seed to market. And we're doing aquaponics. This is actually a system here at the university that we worked on a project with the university to develop a system that that you could put in your basement. But it got a little out of hand. The system got to be so big that and there it is. So, and while we were doing it, I was like, this is a little big. I don't know nobody with a basement this big that they could give up that much space. But it turned out that it do work and everything. And this is another one. I was like, oh, everything at the university is big, you know? We're regular people. So, and that's the aquaponics for me, and Cherry might not agree. I always figured I want things that I could do 12 months out the year. And she always say, well, don't you want to take a break for 2 or 3 months? You know, we could travel. But I'm like, no, I always want to be making money. So this is that was the aquaponic system. And we actually have that still going now. And it's easy. And the good thing about aquaponics is I would say that, you know, if you have children, they really get into the whole fish and water thing and no soil, because you don't use soil in aquaponics. And the first thing they'll say is, you always say we got to have good soil to grow a plant. And I say, well, you know, get used to it. People are going to say things and change it throughout your life. But they really get interested in that.
Okay, we've mentioned it a couple of times, but value-added products pretty quickly became an important part of our mix. I'll just read this. So this is kind of just a synopsis of some of the different value-added products. So zucchini becomes zucchini bread morsels. Herbs become herb-infused vinegar. Too many tomatillos became salsa verde. Excess veggies became cha-cha relish. Burlap coffee bags are used and sold for weed barrier and are made into art. And the Mini Hooper home scale hoop house is developed and built at different locations. So we'll look at each of those. Go ahead. So this is, as Tim was saying, when you end up with too big zucchinis, what to do. And we did start developing first just zucchini bread that we were cutting slice by slice and selling at the market. Eventually it developed into the little cake shape that was happening down the lower left-hand corner, which proved to be kind of a pain in the neck. And then eventually into the delectable zucchini morsels in the lower right-hand corner, which sold really well. We're selling those little guys. I mean, they're really good ingredients, pretty much all organic ingredients, but we're selling those like $3 for $5 at the market. Okay. And the next product for us was herb-infused vinegar, and that came about because we, because we had a friend who had planted four rows of Thai basil that were all flowering, and she called and said, help, help. So I ran over and cut all the flowers off of her Thai basil, and then I thought I had a grocery bag full of Thai basil blossoms, which are just beautiful and smell so great, and I thought there must be something you can do with this. So we ended up developing herb-infused vinegar, and one flavor turned into 11 flavors, and so now we sell 11 flavors of herb-infused vinegar at the market. Same deal with the tomatillos. You know, one year somehow we had a lot of volunteer tomatillos, so lots of pounds of those turned into salsa verde. And we found sort of a niche there. There just wasn't anybody at Mill City that was ready doing that, so that was kind of a nice additional product for us. And then excess veggies turning into cha-cha. It's kind of a traditional relish in the South. Different people from different areas call it different things, but it gets used on hamburgers or hot dogs, or really you can use cha-cha on almost anything. But what's really great about it is you can use almost any leftover vegetable in it. So cabbage is usually at the base of it. Okay. And then a really odd product is we were using coffee bags that we have a great source for as weed barrier in the garden. And we discovered, you can go to the next slide. So this is just showing how we're using it. And they work pretty well, you know, to keep the weeds down. And so we were using those. Next slide. And then eventually we discovered it would be, because we had more than, again, what we needed, we were selling them also. And we continue to sell those every year at the Friends School plant sale. So that's, again, another nice source of income for us. And then eventually, you know, some of these coffee bags are pretty cute. Maybe a little too cute to put down on the ground and walk on. So I started stretching them, and we sell coffee bag art at the Mill City Farmers Market now, too. And then this is a little, as Tim was mentioning about the whole idea of having aquaponics at a human scale where you can do it at home, in the basement or whatever. Same thing with the Mini Hooper. You know, we had put up these really large high tunnels in St. Paul that were, when people saw them, they just couldn't really relate to them. You know, they're out of scale. And so we decided to develop the Mini Hooper. And so this little guy is made with a cattle panel just bent over and then plastic over the top. And we put a couple of raised beds at the base. And these we installed with different groups at a couple of different places. One of them is at Great River High School. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Tim was saying just the size is nice because it's more transportable. Like, we carried this down to the Mill City Farmers Market to show there. And that's why you see it there in the back of the truck. And then we, it's basically like 7 feet wide and 7 feet high. And then the nice thing about it is the cattle panel is about 50 inches wide, so you can do it in 4 foot increments. So we built a 12 foot long one at Great River School, and then a 16 foot long one. This is the one at Pilgrim Church. And so you can just do whatever module works. And then the raised beds are made out of cedar so that they're okay for use next to plants. Okay, this is you. We're on slide 44.
So I'll go back a little. This is one thing, if you contact us, or I would like to see a few people get together. Me and Cherry actually have put together the mini hooper, just the two of us. And there's something that used a good thing to start out to learn how to do a hoop house where you don't have to learn from the biggest. One or two people could put it together and one person could take care of it. And so that's a good way to learn about season extension. And this is the car all ready for market. We have a variety of things in there. And one of the things that we worked on was we tried a lot of different things with marketing. And this is at home. This is when we were doing a CSA. That's Cherry's sister and another friend. Part of the thing, the opportunity that people got was in having, if you were getting a share, then you also were able to come in and do some help prepping your vegetables. So I thought that was pretty good. And CSA is the Community Supported Agriculture. And what that is you plan your crop for the year, and then you get people to invest in you in the beginning of the year. And that was a good way for us to get some upfront money. And then each week or two, causing what CSA you're with, then you get a bag or box of groceries. And so that's what a CSA is.
We call theirs kind of an urban CSA because people are used to a CSA being like a huge volume of vegetables, and that's just not what we were doing. We were doing kind of a bag of vegetables, like a shoulder bag of vegetables, and more like the size that would work for a family. I think people usually find that often they just get too much, and so we tried to right size it so that it wasn't like people had to like get a half a share.
Okay, and one of the things that I really like and Cherry really liked too is doing markets. And so this is once we got our logo all developed and everything. She likes to keep it really looking good. I'll put the stuffed vegetables on the table and it'll look good like that for me. But so we started at Mill City Market. Then we were doing Linden Hills, and I actually worked on the east side to help start a market on the Bluff. And that market, I worked there for 2 years, and we started that market to be at a vendor's market. I was the only one getting paid, and I told them if they could start doing their own activities, then the market would be theirs. And so after 2 years, they started their own market, the east side marketer. And it's still going. And these are some of our value-added products. These are, first we have the microgreens, and we sell those 1 ounce for $3 and two packages for $5. Then we have our herb-infused vinegar. And I think a bottle of that sells for $9. A bottle of the herb-infused vinegar sell for $9.50, and then the coffee art, those sell for $40, $35. And the good thing about everything that we sell, we grow most of the stuff, we do our own packaging, we do our own sales, so we kind of worked hard to cut out the middleman, you know. But you do sometimes need people to help you sell stuff. But we wanted to be able to do as many things ourselves as we could. And we started doing the microgreens in the basement. And now we've moved on to a warehouse. So I always say, when you start something, you shouldn't just dive all the way in. You know, stick your toe in, see if the water is right and everything, and then walk in so you could go at your speed. We started with doing just a little, and it ramped up quick. And this is at the one on the left is at at the Midtown Global Market, and we will go different places and we do markets, and that's basically how our setup goes. This one is at the Arboretum, and excuse me, and that's another way we sell. So that's basically how we set up. You want to do it? And one of the big things that I like, and it's also profitable, is we like to do education. So I always tell people that in real life, I'm a youth worker. You know, I just do farming. Most people don't want me to farm. They say, well, come in and work with our kids to do farms. So this is at the North End Urban Farm, a group of youth that used to come there, and we would walk them through and teach them different things. And we always planted some small stuff. I think you see the little girl with some little cherry tomatoes. So we always did some fun stuff like that that they could just pick off and eat or try or whatever. And then this is actually Cherry speaking to a group in Minneapolis about they're diabetics. So we used to go in and talk to them about the different kind of things that they could do to control their diabetes or even be able to prevent it. Yeah, and those are some of the plants that we did. Two years, I always try to encourage people to grow something. And we did a yard in South Minneapolis of all containers. So all of the whole yard was just little containers of things, and it worked well. This is at in the top left, that's me talking to a group of people about this one was about how to maintain a hoop house or high tunnel. They came out with their yellow and blue hats. I was like, well. So that's what we did. We talked to them about it, and then once we would talk to them about it, they were able to come back and actually help to do some stuff. And on the bottom is a tour that we were a part of a couple years ago. A lot of legislatures and just regular people. Most of our stuff, I try to target it toward the regular person. You know, if you come, then you get some education, and I want it to actually be usable. And this is one of the things we say, it's an opportunity for reflection. And we came up with that. This is at Boys Totem Town, which is a youth correctional facility. And we used to go up there and help them put their garden back together. But one of the big things was we also, when they would come out, we would have a chance to talk to them. And, you know, they tell war stories about how when I was outside, I used to do this and I used to do that. And the police came, I said, well, if you're going to be a criminal and you study in and out of jail, you probably need to find something else. So why don't you go over there, pull some weeds and think about it. And so that's how we used to do that, let them think about it. And hopefully they wouldn't be back. And we also, part of the thing we did there with the stuff that they grew in the first year, we just got them together with growing stuff. In the second year, then we started talking to them about what you can actually do with what you learn. So if a kid was in there for, say, selling weed, I said, well, you know, kind of the same mathematics that you put into getting marijuana or whatever and splitting it up, it's the same mathematics you have to use for doing the market. So if you got a pound of tomatoes and you know you need to make this much money, think about if it was a pound of weed and you had to make that much money and split it up the same way. So one of the things we wanted to do was use what they know, how you transfer that into something useful. And I'm like, you know, and if you do tomatoes, I might see you at the market. If you do weed, I'll probably see you back here. So, you know, give them time to think about how that really works. And we still are really into community engagement. So this is at North End. There is a group called the Picnic Operetta. they came there and performed, and this was next to a large apartment complex, so it was a mix of different people from the suburbs and people from right across the street, so that was always fun to see how different people react to the same thing. And we also hosted international students. I think the guy up by the Big Pumpkin, I think he was from Korea. He was from Japan. He's from Saudi Arabia, and he's from Colombia. So one of the things that we always got to do was talk about food. You know, everybody eats, and everybody eats some of the same things. So that's some of the ways we connected with them. And this is our off-farm job. This is at
Yeah, so about 3 years ago, well, 3.5 years ago, we started working on contract with Frogtown Farm to help with soil development, because this is just a really long process. It was about 8-9 years in the making, getting Frogtown Farm off the ground. And we'd been involved a little bit at the beginning, coming to some of the community meetings and stuff. And then eventually it was clear that we had to think about what was going on with the soil. So we worked with them for a couple of years to help develop the soil. And as is often the case with urban farms, things were more complicated than they seemed to begin with. So what ended up happening is there were a couple of different groups of buildings that had been up there. People might be familiar with the site. It was where Wilder headquarters was located. And before that, the Sisters of the Good Shepherd had a big old castle-like, sort of a building up there. Both had been demolished, but I don't think they took a brick away because they were all still there under the ground. So where there's this whole terrific plan about deep ripping and, you know, tilling and et cetera, et cetera. It became really clear as soon as the city took possession of the land and had the first opportunity to run a backhoe through it at 5 different locations that there was so much debris under the ground that the theory of deep ripping, there was just not equipment that could do that work. So we ended up bringing in 140 semi-loads of soil. And at this site, you know, and that wasn't even covering the whole farm. It's a 5-acre site. There's 3 acres that are intended to be sort of, you know, annual vegetable production, but it's a mix of annual and perennial. And I think what was cool about this opportunity is we got to help just develop the site. And it meant putting in a bunch of permaculture type of installation where there are fruit trees and Berman swale and water management, and worked with some really great consultants to make some of that happen. And we also were able to do the work to make it certified organic in its first year of production. So this was a great opportunity. And then Tim was, as we mentioned earlier, you can go ahead. The market manager at Market on the Bluff. And so those are just other jobs that we had that were actual jobs besides our own business. Go ahead. And then we just wanted to mention that one of the things that's been really important to us during our whole, you know, urban agriculture career has been being really involved with different organizations. I'm a Ramsey County Master Gardener. You know, there's a lot of different organizations that we have been involved with and different initiatives and events and et cetera. And I feel like that's been a really core and important part of our whole, kind of the holistic approach. Flip to the next one. And then I'll just mention here that we were honored to be recognized as Ramsey County Farm Family of 2013. And do you have something else?
I don't know how long we still have, but do anybody have questions? I'll say one of the things that was real important for us was to still work with the community. I was actually a board member for EJAM. And part of as being a board member, that gave us opportunity to work on the cultural, what was this? Well, we helped helped start a food justice council that was a multicultural food justice council. So there were Native people, Native American, Hispanic, Hmong, myself, and Cherry. So it was a diverse group, and everybody came together, and we got to talk about what was important to us in farming. For me, it was important getting stuff to market. For another lady, it was important for her to save some of their traditional seeds. So she was not, she was into the stuff that would grow, but she was more into the seeds that would come from squash. She was more into squash seeds and being able to save them and give them to other people from her culture. And we worked with Homegrown Minneapolis and the Ramsey County Food and Nutrition thing. One thing that I really liked working on, we worked with the Cultural Wellness Center in what's called the Backyard Initiative, and that was in Minneapolis, and that was just really getting people to actually just get started to growing anything. And that was where we had the container garden. So we, I did about 100 little pots. And then if somebody would come over or come by and look, then I would be like, yeah, come on, take one. Go and put it on your apartment balcony or whatever. And that was really one way that I went. So I had rented a little apartment so we could have the basement to start the aquaponics. And on one side of me was a Hispanic family, and then upstairs from them was a Kenyan family. Then on the other side, there was a Somalian family. And in the building that I stayed in, it was me and Cherry, so that was African-American and Caucasian. And nobody was really talking there to anybody. The Kenyans would talk to each other, the Hispanics would talk to each other. So I say, I know what to do. So I planted some beans on the fence, and I planted some peppers behind them. So people would come by, and they would look at the beans, and, you know, so I started talking to them. And then so they would start come over to get some beans and the peppers. I planted peppers, and I planted epazote. Epazote is a Hispanic seasoning. And so that made the Hispanic dude come over, and the way he started talking to me was, I would say, oh, get you a pepper. He'd say, no, not pepper, chile. I said, okay, you taught me something. So we used that, and that was really fun because we taught each other a lot of things. And just the food being out there really made everybody start talking. And there was a business behind me that did community work. So I got them to start doing a kind of marketish thing where everybody was bringing something over to sell, and it actually started turning into not really a market, but a way to demonstrate the food that you knew how to cook, and then we would just get together and eat. So if I say, well, I'm gonna show you how we cook peppers, and if I say it to the Hispanic dude, I'm gonna make some salsa verde and it's gonna be the best. The first thing he would say is, you don't know nothing about making salsa verde, let me show you how to really do it. And so that's the way we start exchanging some recipes, and that was really good. Yeah. And do anybody have questions or?
All your value added products, do you make them at home or do you use a commercial kitchen?
No, we make them at home, and you want, those are mostly Cherry's things.
So. Yeah. Yeah, we do make them at home, and we're under the cottage foods law, which now is like maximum 18,000 or something. So we're okay as long as we don't end up getting too big. But we have looked into the idea of doing some production in a commercial kitchen so that we could actually do distribution to through wholesale, as opposed to, you know, with the cottage foods law, you have to sell it directly to the end user. Is anybody? Oh.
My question is, I know that you can plan your thing in basement, and how do you sell and do the full regulation come to you, or how do you apply for it?
it sounded like you say, how do you apply to do the value-added products, the food residue? Well, there's not really a license that you have to apply for. It's mostly getting some education, and I forgot his name, so I'm going to put him out there anyway. That young man sitting right behind you, I think might be able to give you some information on aquaponics because we work together. It's not really a license, and for the cottage food, you could Google the cottage food bill or the cottage food law, and it's pretty simple. The thing that you have to really be aware of is the cleanliness. If there's probably some, and the stuff that we started in the basement, we started off by starting plants in the basement. And with that, the main thing that we had to be aware of was moisture issues. When you have that much water moving around in your house, then you have to watch out for like mold and stuff. But there weren't really a lot of things that we had to contact the city for. But we had to figure out the rotation for the plants. And then also when you're doing aquaponics, you're not getting one or two fish a day. It's gonna come a day where you might have 100 fish at once that you have to figure out what to do with.
I'm gonna say one other thing too. Go ahead.
Well, the thing that I found out it's easier to just, the first round that we did, I actually gave them away because we didn't have a really, that's gonna be, you can start the aquaponics, but you have to figure out what to do with the fish, and a lot of fish at once. So we started looking into how could you move them around, and we just took them right out the system, put them on ice in a cooler, and then took them to some people. So for us, I think with anything, when you're doing farming or markets or anything, if you're delivering stuff whole, then it's good. You're not processing it, but once you take a knife or a fork or a spoon or anything and cut into it, you're in a whole different world. That's when you're going to have a lot of regulations. So with the fish, we took them right out the system, put them on ice in a cooler, and delivered them. And that's that'll most likely be the way we'll do things once we even get up into large-scale production. Well, no, we're not doing those at home. We actually do in the warehouse and on the east side.
And if I can just say something really quick about
she added, that. She added.
Can I just finish? I just wanted to say one thing that we kind of learned, too, is that farming is oddly not considered to be a home occupation in the city of St. Paul. And so whatever we're growing at home, we're eating. Got it? Yeah. Whatever we're growing at home is not farm, it's not going to market, it's home consumption. That should change because people should be able to grow things. In fact, when we started growing things on the lot next door to us, they were saying, well, with the changes in the ag rules and stuff, that we would have to legally divide that lot in order to, and I said, that's ridiculous. And they sort of said, yeah, it is. So it's really, I think it's ongoing in its development. And I think all of us pushing the envelope a little bit is good. I feel like we just have to do that with the hoop house, with the deer fence. I just was in touch with DSI at St. Paul about a shipping container house. And they said, no, you can't do that because of foundation and whatever. And then I found out that there was going to be one at the home and remodeling show. So I called them back and said, maybe you want to go take a look at that because I think it's coming our direction. You might want to be aware. So anyway, I just think the more we work with them and help them to understand then changes happen. I know when we did our first hoop house, they required us to put in 4 foot deep, 12 inch diameter concrete footings under every hoop, which was way overkill. A year later, hoop houses were going in like this with no concrete, no backfill, no whatever. We had to epoxy coat all of the elements that went into the ground. I mean, it was really involved. We had to hire an engineer, you know. And so I'm sorry, somebody else had another question. I'll just say, yeah, so that's pretty much it. I just wanted to mention that it's an ongoing kind of a work in progress to get where we're all headed. Yeah, we've spent our share of time in front of the city council talking about why things should be different. And I think that they do find it compelling when you talk about North End is a perfect example where you're farming there for 3 years and now all of a sudden you can't farm there anymore. Oh, I don't even want to know. Tim was just saying, how much money did we put into that? And I said, I don't really want to know. It's not even just the money, it's the time. I mean... Okay, it was the time and the money. But, you know, it's a major investment. And then to have the rug pulled out from under you, and then you have to somehow regroup from that. And we all know this is not a business where there's a huge profit margin. So, you know, it's really hard to be prepared for that kind of a setback. But, I know the farmers that I know are all really resourceful. And... you know, kind of figure out their way as they go along. So congratulations to all of you. Any other questions?
I'm just curious. I'm sorry I came in a little late. Maybe you talked about this before. But what in particular was the rule change that caused you the problem that you just talked about up in North End?
Actually, that wasn't a rule change. That was a situation with the land ownership. It was owned by a nonprofit organization. They bought it in 2006, which was not a great time to buy land. And so they were not able to put together the project they needed to in order to, there was HUD dollars in it. There was City of St. Paul dollars in it. And they basically couldn't make it pencil out to do the work that they needed to do for the requirements for HUD. And so the city took the land back from them because they couldn't afford the taxes even on it. And it was, you know, I mean, the city was really stuck. It wasn't anybody's fault. It's just the way it was. They had to do something that either provided jobs or provided housing, one of the two, with that land. They could have maybe... given the HUD money back, but that seemed dicey. Anyway, it was complicated.
So it wasn't land use law causing the problem?
What?
It wasn't land use law or changes in ordinances?
No, we felt like that whole situation was a really, really fortunate situation for us to begin with, because usually when somebody has excess land like that, they might think about doing a community garden, but this organization really wanted to support people who were like farming and growing for market. And that group of people doesn't often get that kind of support. So it was us, it was the Association for the Advancement Among Women in Minnesota and Stone's Throw that each had a third of that land. And that was a huge benefit. I mean, they paid to put water in. That's a big deal. I mean, for us, the things that are most critical are land permanence and water, you know. We've had sites that people go, yeah, you should use that site, but there's no water. You know, it's like if you don't have the resources, it's just not even worth the time. And Tim's just reminding me of just the whole thing with our own land where we have, you know, it's 0.2 acre, if you will. It's a double lot in St. Paul. And not only did we have to deal with the city on the hoop house, but we also had to deal with the city on compost because we were building, we had three compost bins in the backyard, and the inspector who came out cited us for the compost bins. And so, you know, I had to, like, do the math, and we figured out that, in fact, we were well within our right for the amount of compost that we had on site. And so I had to go meet with the city and meet, you know, with a judge and talk to them about our what we were doing there. And I said, wow, you know, now that you bring it up, it looks like we could have about twice as much compost. Good to know. So give me this.
Thank you, guys. I think our time is up about 10 minutes ago. but yeah, so I think part of the thing is we have to really work with the city. One person we work with is Karen Clark on different urban ag bills and stuff like that, because as we're learning, some of the rules are good rules. They're just outdated. So we need to work with the city or the county or whoever the officials are to be able to make them really more usable for us. Then I think we're done.
Yelele, mama we, yelele.